Well, this morning we are continuing in our study through the Gospel of John. We're up to chapter 1, verses 3 to 5. And if you've been around for the last number of weeks, you'll know that John has started his Gospel account in a certain kind of way. He started his Gospel account talking about Jesus really by drawing our attention to what is called the deity of Jesus. In other words, before John begins recalling and retelling about Jesus' life here on earth, well, he first wants to emphasize the fact that Jesus eternally existed as God even before the earth was brought into existence. And we know that the reason why Jesus eternally existed before coming to earth is the fact that Jesus Christ is in fact God. Now, we've spent several weeks thinking through what it is that the Apostle John has to say in verses 1 and 2 of John chapter 1. We have spent time thinking about the fact that Jesus is eternally God, that Jesus is equally God, and that Jesus is essentially God. We've spent time thinking about the fact that Jesus is co-equally God within what we call the Trinity, or the Godhead, along with God the Father and God the Holy Spirit. And really, that brings us right up to today's passage of verses 3 to 5. And what we see here in verses 3 to 5, it's very much a continuation of thought from what it is that John first started with in verses 1 and 2 of John chapter 1. In today's passage, really what John is doing, he's giving to us further evidence for the deity of Christ, further evidence for the fact that Jesus Christ is God. Now, by way of an outline, this is how John does this. He points us to the truth of Jesus being the source of life. That is the big thought. That is the primary idea that we see in verses 3 to 5. Jesus is the source of life. And if we want to break that down a little bit, we're going to divide it into two main parts for our study today. We're going to see firstly in verse 3 that Jesus is the source of physical life. That's part, the first part. And secondly, in verses 4 and 5, we're going to see that Jesus is the source of spiritual life. So verse 3, the source of physical life. Verses 3 and 4, the source of spiritual, or we might want to call it eternal life. In verses 1 and 2, we've seen how Christ's deity relates to eternity past, whereas here in verses 3 to 5, we're going to see how Jesus' deity relates to human history here in the present. And so let's give our attention, first of all, give it to verse 3, and in verse 3, this is where we see Jesus as the source of physical life. Notice how John puts it there. Notice it in your Bibles in verse 3. He says, all things were made through him, speaking of God the Son, talking about Jesus Christ. All things were made through him, and without him, nothing was made that was made. Now we can see what he's saying here, right? He's pointing to the fact that Jesus Christ is the source of physical life. Now, we can break this down really into three further points. Three main things that we can draw from what it is that John is saying right here in verse 3. The first main thing that we can draw in verse 3 is that it provides further evidence for the deity of Christ. It provides further evidence for the deity of Jesus. That's the very first thing that we can draw from verse 3. After all, as we've studied throughout our Bibles, well, what do we see? What do we see? Who does our Bibles tell us is responsible for bringing into existence the heavens and the earth? Who does the Bible tell us who's responsible for creating the heavens and the earth? The Bible tells us the one person who is responsible is God. For instance, Genesis chapter 1, verse 1. For the newest believer, the first person opening up the first page of their Bible, what are they going to see? They're going to see in Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. It tells us. God is the one who's responsible. Psalm 102, 25, of old you, God, have laid the foundation of the earth, and the heavens are the work of your hands. We see in Isaiah chapter 40, verse 28, "Have you not known? Have you not heard? The everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, neither faints nor is weary. His understanding is unsearchable." Everlasting God, the Lord, is creator. We see this also in Isaiah 42, verse 5. "For thus says God, the Lord, who created the heavens and stretched them out, who spread forth the earth that which comes from it, who gives breath to the people on it, the spirit to those who walk on it. Creator of heavens, creator of the earth." In Isaiah 45, verse 18, it says, "For thus says the Lord, who created the heavens, who is God, who formed the earth and made it, who established it, who did not create it in vain, who formed it to be inhabited, I am the Lord, and there is no other." So what are we seeing here? What we are seeing here is that without a shadow of a doubt, we see within inspired scripture, we see within the Bible, we see within the Word of God, that God is the author of creation. God is the author of all that has been brought into existence on earth and in heaven. Out of nothing, God spoke into existence all that we see within the universe today. Now, of course, what is this telling us? It is telling us, what is it telling us specifically about Jesus? Well, it's telling us, for John to say that all things were made through Jesus, and that without him, nothing that was made was made. And if elsewhere in the Bible it tells us that God is the one that he has created all things, well, what is it doing? It's simply providing further evidence for the truth that Jesus is in fact God. Apostle John is attributing creation to Jesus, and we see elsewhere that creation is attributed to God, therefore Jesus equals God. So that's the first thing that we can draw from verse 3. The first thing is further evidence for the truth that Jesus is in fact God. But there's a second thing that we can draw from verse 3 as well. For you note takers who like to jot down notes, this would be the sort of second sub-point in your little outline there. The second thing that we can draw from verse 3 is that Jesus most certainly had an active role in creation. Not only is he God, but it tells us that Jesus wasn't just a bystander when the heavens and the earth were being brought into existence. We see that this truth is most prominently told within the New Testament. For instance, the specific, area of responsibility and of Christ's involvement in bringing about the creation of the universe is most explicitly taught within the New Testament. For instance, we saw this a couple of weeks ago on our Sunday afternoon service, but Colossians chapter 1, verse 16, it says, "For by him, that is by Jesus, all things were created that are on heaven and that are on earth, the visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or principalities or powers, all things were created through him and for him." In Ephesians chapter 3, verse 9, it says, "The mystery which was from the beginning of the ages has been hidden in God, who created all things through Jesus Christ." And then we get to Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 to 2. It says, "God, who at various times and in various ways spoke in time past to the fathers by the prophets, has in these last days spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, through whom also he made the worlds." And then we come to Hebrews chapter 1, verses 8 to 10. Just again, what are we doing? It's reinforcing that the New Testament teaches elsewhere that Jesus was in fact participating in the author of creation. It says in Hebrews chapter 1, verses 8 to 10, "But to the Son, he says, your throne, O God, is forever and ever. The scepter of righteousness, the scepter of your kingdom. You have loved righteousness and hated lawlessness. Therefore, God, your God, has anointed you with the oil of gladness more than your companions. And you, Lord, in the beginning, laid the foundations of the earth. The heavens are the work of your hands. It's very clear, isn't it? You know, for anyone who was unconvinced, you must be convinced if you're taking the Bible as your source document, your source of truth. It is clear from these New Testament passages that God the Son, Jesus Christ, most certainly had an active role in creating the universe. And this is the second thing, really, that verse 3 tells us. Not only is it further evidence for the fact that Jesus is God, but it also tells us that Jesus had an active involvement in bringing about the existence of the universe. But I guess even a related point I think is important for us to probably just get our heads around at this point as well, is that in addition to creating all things, we know by God's word that Jesus actually has an active role in sustaining all things. So not only was he the original creator, but he is the present sustainer of all things as well. How do we know this? Well, for instance, in Colossians chapter 1, verse 17, as soon as Paul has talked about Jesus being the author of creation, well, he goes on to say, "And he is before all things, and in him all things consist." That is, in him all things are held together. The reason that things aren't just flying out of space, the reason that things are holding together in the universe and the way in which they are, is because Jesus and his sustaining power is doing this very present work. Now we see the sustaining power of Christ also talked about in Hebrews chapter 1 verses 2 to 3. He says in verse 3, "Who," speaking of Jesus, "being the brightness of his glory, the express image of his person," and he says, "upholding all things by the word of his power." Again, that same idea. He created, yes, but he is also sustaining us as well. And how is everything being sustained? How is the order of the universe in which we see today being sustained? Well, Hebrews 1 tells us it's by the power of Christ's word. In other words, he spoke it, and by the power of his word, the universe was not only brought into existence, but it is held together even to this very day. Now, what is this telling us? Well, it's telling us that Jesus, the Son of God, had an active role in creation, but he also has an active role in sustaining the universe that he brought into existence. He brought it together by the power of his word. Some people think that it might take a long time for the earth to be destroyed. It would take lots of processes, a whole lot of time, and all this. No, it doesn't. No, it doesn't. If Jesus spoke the word into existence, he could easily speak again, and it would be no more. Just by his word. That is the power of the word of Christ. Now, sometimes we read this and we see, okay, the New Testament is primarily saying that God the Son had this active role in creation. And sometimes it can be thought that God the Son was the only person within the Godhead who was involved in the creation of the universe. And we can understand why. When we're reading through the New Testament verses and New Testament accounts about creation, well, we see that creation is primarily attributed to Jesus. However, it's good for us to keep in mind that Scripture also teaches that each person of the Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, they were all involved in some way when it came to the creation of the universe. And as we mentioned a few weeks ago, there's a little tiny hint of the plurality of the Godhead, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bringing creation into existence. There's a little hint of that right in the very first book, in the very first verse of the Bible. In Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth," we know it says there. And as we mentioned a couple weeks ago, the Hebrew word for God in this verse is Elohim, and it's written in the plural form. It allows for a plurality in God. It was not just God singular who created the heavens and the earth, but it was God plural in the sense it was the triune God. It was Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Now, if we need any more evidence to this, you just have to go down a little bit further in Genesis chapter 1, verse 26. And we see plural language being used once again when it comes to the creation of mankind. It says in Genesis 1, 26, "Then God said, 'Let us make man in our image, according to our likeness, and let him have dominion over the fish of the sea, the birds of the air, cattle, earth, over every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth.'" And so we see here, it doesn't say, "Son, you go and do that. Christ, you go and do that." But it says, "Let us," plural, "let us make man in our image, according to our likeness." And sure enough, when we come to the New Testament, Paul talks about the Father's involvement in creation. One place is 1 Corinthians chapter 8 and verse 6. And this is where he says, "For even if there are so-called gods, whether in heaven and on earth, as there are many gods and many lords, yet for us there is one God and Father, of whom are all things, and we for him, and one Lord Jesus Christ, through whom are all things, and through whom we live." And so we're seeing both Father and Son. It's a clear affirmation of the equal essence or the equal nature of the Father and the Son, including their involvement in bringing creation into existence. And then we read passages about the Holy Spirit's involvement in creation. We see passages such as Job chapter 26, verse 13. It says, "By his Spirit he adorned the heavens, his hand pierced the fleeing serpent." Psalm 104:30, "You send forth your Spirit, they are created, and you renew the face of the earth." But perhaps the passage that speaks most clearly to the involvement of the Trinity when it comes to creation, it perhaps has to be Revelation chapter 4 and verse 11. If we back it up to Revelation chapter 4, verse 8, this is what it says. It says, "The four living creatures, each having six wings, were full of eyes around and within, and they do not rest day or night, saying, 'Holy, holy, holy, Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come.'" Little side note, when you see that phrase, "holy, holy, holy," why say holy three times? It's because it's referring to the worship of the triune God. Holy is God the Father. Holy is God the Son. Holy is God the Holy Spirit. And so the worship there initially is going to the triune God. But then continuing the worship of the Trinity, it says in verse 9 of Revelation chapter 4, "Whenever the living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to him who sits on the throne, who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders fall down before him who sit on the throne and worship him who lives forever and ever. They cast their crowns before the throne, saying," now listen carefully, listen to how the worship of the triune God is being expressed in the heavenly realm. It says, "You are worthy, O Lord, to receive glory, honor, and power, for you created all things, and by your will they exist and were created." So do we see what's happening here? We are given somewhat of a snapshot of what's taking place in heaven, where the triune God, Father, Son, Spirit, is being worshipped continually, holy, holy, holy. And one of the things that they are worshipping the Trinity for is the Trinity's involvement in the creation of the universe. In other words, there is no distinction when it comes to who should be worshipped for creation, but instead, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are all being worshipped equally for bringing creation into existence. So what is it telling us? Well, it's telling us that the Creator is the triune God. It's telling us that God the Son or God the Holy Spirit are not just mere instruments of the Creator, but instead the Creator is one. He is Father, Son, Holy Spirit. And it's for this reason we, like those in heavenly realms, we are to give reverence and worship for all three persons of the Trinity, of the triune God, equally worthy of worship, of praise for bringing creation into existence. And so what have we seen so far in verse 3? What was the first thing? First thing is that it's providing further evidence for the deity of Christ. Second thing that we're seeing is that it's telling us Jesus most certainly had an active role in bringing about creation. But there's a third thing as well. And that third thing we can draw from verse 3 here is the fact that Jesus is not a created being, but that he is the actual creator. While Jehovah's Witnesses will say that Jesus is the Archangel Michael, while Mormons will say that Jesus was the brother of Lucifer, a created being, while many false teachers in the first century church said that Jesus was merely a created being, or sometimes just a mere man, what does the Word of God say? Well, what the Word of God tells us here in John chapter 1, verse 3, it says that without him, nothing was made that was made. In other words, it's impossible for Jesus to be a created being because there has nothing that has been made, nothing that has been brought into existence, nothing that has had a starting point which has not been brought into being by Jesus Christ himself. So what is that doing? It's pointing us to the truth that Jesus is the source of life, and this is the place that John first directs our thoughts when it comes to this very thing. He directs our thoughts in verse 3 to the truth that Jesus is the source of physical life. Now think about that for a moment. Just sit on that thought for a moment. Jesus is the source of physical life. Think about that. Think about the fact that Jesus, the Son of God, is personally responsible for bringing not just all things into existence, but think about this for a moment. He is responsible for bringing you into existence. Jesus is personally responsible for giving you life. And think about that. Jesus didn't have to give you life. Jesus didn't have to bring you into existence. He could have chosen to bring other people into existence, but he could have chosen to exclude bringing you into existence. And what's more, before you think you're going to protest about that very thing, you wouldn't have known any different because you wouldn't be here. You wouldn't exist. Think about this. Think about the fact that Jesus did choose to bring you into existence. Think about the fact that your life is not merely an accident. Think about that. Think about the fact that Jesus personally saw to it that not only your body, but your soul would be created from nothing, yet it would exist eternally once created. Not only has Jesus specifically created you, think about this. Not only is your life not an accident, think about this. Think about Jesus is specifically sustaining you, right? We saw it in Colossians 1, right? All things consist, all things are being held together. The reason that creation exists in the way that it does is because Jesus is sustaining it. And I want you to think about that personally right now. Think about the fact that Jesus Christ is personally sustaining you right now. Think about the fact that he is giving you every single breath that you breathe. We think to ourselves, well, I wouldn't even think about breathing, right? We think, well, I guess this breath will be followed by the next breath. No, every single breath that we breathe is a gift from God, and God has given that to us. He's giving your heart the ability to beat every single time that it beats. He's giving your lungs the ability to inhale and exhale every time you take in or expel air. Now, we like to think that our bodies are on autopilot. We like to think that our bodies are just going to keep on functioning the way that they are until we hit the ripe old age of 86 years old or whenever the average, you know, life expectancy is within New Zealand at this point, but that is simply not the case. The Bible says that our days, they are numbered by God. God has not only purposed for our beginning, the beginning of our existence, but he has also preordained the extent of our bodily life right here on earth. And in the meantime, in between the time of the beginning of our existence to the time where he's extended it to how long it will be on earth, Jesus is sustaining us. He is preserving us. He's enabling our heart, lungs, other vital parts of our body to function for whatever duration he has purposed for them to function. Again, Jesus has not only specifically created you, but think about the fact that Jesus Christ is presently sustaining you. What does that mean? Well, it means that every single year that you are alive, it is specifically a gift from Christ. Every single month that you are alive, it is a gift from Christ. Every single week, every single day, dare I say, every single second that you're alive is a gift from Christ, because he has both created you and he is sustaining you. Think about that. Ponder that. And as you're pondering that, be asking yourself the question, what should I be doing with the life that Christ has given to me? How should I be spending my time with whatever remaining duration that Christ has given to me to live with on this the very earth? My life is not an accident, but Jesus Christ has specifically been purposed for me to be brought into existence at this specific time. And so why, Lord? Why, God? What would you have me be about? How would you have me use the life that you have so graciously granted to me? All things were created through him, and without him, nothing that was made was made. Well, that's Jesus being the source of physical life, right? We've talked about the physical for a little bit. Now let's jump over to the spiritual. Because not only is Jesus the source of physical life, verse 3, but when we look to verses 4 and 5, we see that Jesus is also the source of spiritual life. Let's give our attention here and notice how John puts it there in verse 4. He says, "In him," that is in Jesus, "was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it." So what is John saying? What is John saying in verses 4 and 5 here? Well, there are actually three main things that we can draw from verses 4 and 5. And the first main thing that we can draw from verses 4 or 5 is simply that eternal life finds its source in Jesus Christ. That's the first thing that we can draw. How do we get this? Well, notice how John puts it in verse 4. He says, "In him was life." Now, on one hand, we see the word life, and where does our thinking immediately default to? What comes to mind when we think that in him was life? Well, we immediately, a lot of times, try to connect it with the previous verse. We try to connect that with verse 3, which talks about Jesus being the source of physical life, and though, okay, it's just a continuation of that. In him was physical life. However, in verse 4, John doesn't have the thought of physical life in mind, but instead John has the thought of spiritual life in mind. In him was spiritual life, eternal life. How do we know this? Well, it really comes down to the Greek word that John chooses to use here. When we see that word life, and it's used elsewhere within Scripture, that same Greek word used elsewhere, it is never used throughout the Bible in terms of physical life. But the same Greek word that's used there for life in verse 4 is only ever used in reference to spiritual life. For instance, let's just take the Gospel of John. John 3:16, we see the same Greek word for life being used in John 3:16, where it says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life." The word life is the same as word is translated in John 1:4. John 3:36, "He who believes in the Son has everlasting life, and he who does not believe in the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abides on him." Then we see in John 5:24, Jesus says, "Most assuredly I say to you, he who hears my word and believes in me, who sent me, has everlasting life." There's the word. "And shall not come into judgment, but is passed from death into life." In John 6:35, we see the same thing again. Jesus says of himself, "I am the bread of life. He who comes to me shall never hunger. He who believes in me shall never thirst." And then in John 6:40, "This is the will of him who sent me," Jesus said, "that everyone who sees the Son and believes in him may have everlasting life, and I will raise him up in that last day." In fact, we could keep on going all day. There's actually 26 other references just in the Gospel of John alone, and each one of those references where they use that word, specific Greek word life, within John's Gospel, it never is referring to physical life. It is only ever referring to spiritual life. Which then, of course, it drives us back to our passage today in John chapter 1, verse 4, when Jesus says, "And in him was life." What is it telling us about Jesus? It's telling us that spiritual or eternal life finds its source in Jesus Christ. In other words, eternal life is not so much a place, but eternal life is in fact a person. A lot of times we think to ourselves, eternal life is a place. Eternal life is when I die and I go to heaven. We equate heaven with eternal life, when what we're seeing here is that it's not so much a place, but eternal life is in fact a person. Jesus says this in John 17:3. He says, "And this is eternal life." Same Greek word. What is eternal life? He says, "That they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent." That is eternal life. Knowing him, being in connection with him. In John 16:4, Jesus refers to himself as the source of eternal life. And he does so by saying this. He says, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." He doesn't say, "I'm going to tell you about the life. I'm going to show you the way of the life." He says, "I am the life. I am eternal life. No one comes to the Father except through me." Now again, what is it telling us? It's telling us that eternal life is not so much a place, but eternal life is in fact a person. And what this means is that if we want to experience eternal life, it's not something that is sometime in the future. If we want to experience eternal life, we need to be connected to, and we need to be in union with, the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. We need to be connected to and in union with the Lord Jesus, and we are connected to him through faith. Do you want to experience eternal life right now? If you are here today and you are not experiencing eternal life, life everlasting, but if you want to get a taste of that right here and right now, you need to be connected with, you need to be in union with Jesus himself. And you want to know how that is possible? It's possible by faith. We are in union by trusting that Jesus died in our place for our sin upon the cross, taking upon himself the wrath that our sin deserves, and then rising triumphantly from the grave 3 days later, ascending into heaven, and now offering to you the gift of everlasting life, which, by the way, is in union and connection with him, if you would receive that gift. And you can receive that gift right now by faith, by trusting in Jesus Christ by putting your confidence in Him. And my friends, right here, right now, you can experience life eternal. But in addition to Jesus being the source of eternal life, there's a second thing that we can draw from verse 4. And the second thing that we can draw from verse 4 is this. Mankind can experience eternal life in the person of Jesus Christ. Not only is He the source of eternal life, but we can experience that in Him. This is what John means in verse 4, where he says, in Him was life, that's the first part, but then notice the second part of verse 4. And the life was the light to men. We can get to experience it. We get to experience the life, the eternal life that is in Christ. Because when we think about it, think about this. When we think about the world, when we think about fallen mankind as a whole, what is the world and what is mankind, naturally speaking, as a whole, what are we characterized by? According to Scripture, we are characterized by what we call spiritual darkness. That's what we're characterized by. Well, what is spiritual darkness? Well, spiritual darkness is characterized by things such as evil. It's characterized by things such as hatred, things such as sin, things such as falsehood. But what does John say in verse 4? John says that Jesus, the source or person of eternal life, is the light to men. The light to mankind. Now, what does it mean? Well, it means where there is evil, Jesus shines goodness. Where there is hatred, Jesus shines love. Where there is sin, Jesus shines holiness. Where there is falsehood, Jesus shines truth. And where there is eternal death, that is eternal separation from God, what does Jesus shine? He shines the offer of eternal life. In John chapter 8, verse 12, Jesus puts it this way. He says, I am the light of the world. He didn't say, I have the light. Like, I've got the torch. He says, I am that light. I am the light of the world. And he who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but notice what it says there, but have the light of life. Any guesses there what Greek word is being used for the word life there? It's the exact same word that John uses back in John chapter 1, verse 4. It's speaking of eternal life. And what a tremendous truth this is. Not only is Jesus the source of eternal or spiritual life, but what does Jesus do with that life? He radiates His life, His eternal life, into ours. His spiritual light shines into our spiritual darkness. And what does that mean? It means that we are able to experience the privilege of everlasting life. So that's the first thing that we can draw. The very first thing that we can draw here is that mankind can experience eternal life. Well, sorry, the second thing is, first is that eternal life finds its source in Jesus Christ. The second thing is that mankind can experience this eternal life in the person of Jesus Christ, which leads us to the third thing that we can draw from verses 4 and 5. And that is, the powers of darkness are no match for the light of Christ. This is what John means in verse 5, where he says, and the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it. The powers of darkness are no match for the light of Christ. You see, the Greek word, it's translated as comprehend there in verse 5. The word means to overcome, means to extinguish. The darkness did not extinguish the light. It did not overcome the light. While it is true that fallen mankind cannot comprehend, cannot understand, cannot accept the light of the gospel of Christ in and of themselves, it's also true that the powers of darkness, they cannot overcome and they cannot extinguish the light of the gospel of Christ either. In fact, one of the important truths that we're going to see right throughout the Gospel of John is that God sovereignly sees to it that the spiritual light of Christ makes its way into the darkened souls of mankind. The light, the life of Christ radiates like light, and it finds itself lightening up the darkness of the souls of mankind so that we get to experience the eternal life that is in Christ. Listen to how Paul puts this in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 3 to 6. He says, "And if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing, whose minds the God of this age has blinded, who do not believe, lest the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine on them." But then we go down to verse 6 and it says, "For it is the God who commanded the light to shine out of darkness who has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ." Do we see what it's saying here? Do we see what Paul is telling us in that Corinthians passage there? He is saying that the God of this age, by the way, that's lowercase g, the God of this age, Satan, is seeking to spiritually blind the minds of fallen mankind. He is actively seeking to keep them in a state of spiritual darkness as a result, meaning that they can't experience the light of Jesus Christ. But what does God do according to 2 Corinthians chapter 4? God sovereignly overrides, God sovereignly overcomes the God of this age, who is Satan, so that the light of the gospel of Christ does what? It shines into the hearts of his people. Think about that picture. Being held captive by Satan, our minds can't think, rightly about the light, about the life. Satan holding our minds, it's like a veil put over our minds in a sense of going, I can't comprehend, I can't understand. And if it was left up to us in and of ourselves, that would be the way that it remained, because we're dead in our trespasses and sins. However, what does God do? He shines the light of the gospel of Christ into the hearts of his people. And the whole thrust of verse 5 is not that the darkness failed to understand the truth about Jesus, but instead the forces of darkness, who only know Jesus all too well, they are incapable, they are unable to stop Christ, to prevent the truth from impacting individual souls within the world. Jesus puts it like this in John 10:10. He says, "The thief does not come except to steal, to kill, and to destroy," that is Satan. But he says, "I have come that they may have life." In case you're wondering, same word, that they may have eternal life and that they may have it more abundantly. Do we see what he's saying there? John 10:10. Same thing as what John's saying back in John 1:4 and 5. That Christ, who is the life, who is eternal life, that life shines into the world in darkness, and it is a light, not only to the world in general, but it's a light which ignites within our hearts that enables us to see Jesus Christ truly for who he is, that we might respond positively to that. I ask you the question this morning, has God shined his light into your heart? Is he showing you the truth about Jesus Christ? Is he showing you that he is the Son of God, that he is God himself, who has come down to earth on a rescue mission to die upon a cross to save you specifically? If that sounds like foolishness to you, It is because Satan, the god of this world, he has veiled your thinking. He is preventing you from thinking correctly about who Jesus is, and therefore the light is not getting through. But my friends, if you're sitting here today, and if you have never really contemplated or thought this before, but you are considering this right now, that Jesus is who he says that he is the creator of all things physically, but he has also come to give you life eternal and spiritually. My friends, that has not just come by coincidence. That is God shining the light of truth about Jesus into your heart right now. And you can, my friends, respond to that light by faith, by trusting that that is who Jesus says that he is. And I would ask you the question this morning. If you are rejecting that light that God is trying to show you and opening up to you within your heart about the truth of Jesus, I ask you the question, what is holding you back? Think of all that you have to lose by not doing it, by not trusting, by not receiving Jesus by faith. But think about this. Think of all that you have to gain by believing him, by taking Jesus Christ at his word. My friends, if he is speaking to your heart this morning, if he is showing you that this God-man, Jesus Christ, what he said is true, that he died in your place for your sins, that he rose again from the dead, I'm saying this morning, do not resist that. Do not try to extinguish that light that God is trying to put into your heart so that he can open you up to the truth and so that you, even today, can experience life eternal. Well, as we bring the study to a close, let us think about this for a moment. Let's think about this and apply it to our lives. We've looked at Jesus being our source of physical light, life. We've seen him as our source of spiritual life. But let's just bring this in and let's kind of land this plane now. Time to bring this plane on down to land. It's time to bring the study to a close. But let's think about this and apply it specifically in this way. Think about the fact that Satan, the God of this age, he has blinded the hearts and our hearts and our understanding from the truth about God. And think about the fact that there was nothing that we could do in and of ourselves to change that blindness, to change that reality. We were caught up in the whirlpool of sin of which we could not jump out of, or which we could not escape. And although we were created by Christ through that entrance of sin into the world, we had no spiritual connection with Christ. We had no spiritual connection with the one who brought us into existence. Think, left to ourselves, we are estranged from Jesus Christ. The Bible says that we were enemies of Jesus Christ. We were enemies of the one who created us because our darkened hearts were against him because of that sin that was abiding within. But think about what Jesus did. And think about this. The one who gave you physical life, he willingly became one of us so that we could experience eternal life. The one who gave us physical life willingly became one of us so that we could experience spiritual life. The one who had eternally existed within the heavens, he knew that we could never reach to heaven, to him, on our own. And so what did Jesus do? Jesus brought heaven down to us. He brought eternal life to us in his person, knowing that relationship with him is, in fact, eternal life. And of course, what do the powers of darkness do? The powers of darkness, they try to extinguish the light of Christ. They tried killing the newborn babies in Bethlehem, thinking that Jesus would be among them. They tried to extinguish it by tempting Jesus in the wilderness, trying to take him off course. And even today, the powers of darkness are seeking to blind the understanding of people about the truth of God. And yet, the Lord Jesus Christ, the light of life, the light of the world, he can never be extinguished. He shone into our lives. Where there was evil, he radiated good. Where there was hatred, he radiates love. Where there is sin, he radiates holiness. Where there is falsehood, he radiates truth. Where there is eternal death, he radiates eternal life. And what's more, he connects us to himself. He connects us to the source of eternal life by faith. My friends, in a moment I'm going to pray. We're going to finish with a song of worship. And as we do, let us sing. Let us sing in response to the Lord Jesus Christ. Let us sing in response to the source of life. And as we respond to the fact, to that very fact that Jesus is the source of life, let us respond specifically that the one who gave us physical life willingly became one of us so that we could experience eternal life. Let us now respond to the light of the world, that very giver of life. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word to us this morning. Thank you by showing us the truth about yourselves. You are the author of physical life. You are the author of eternal spiritual life. And Lord, help us to know how we best are to respond to both of those. Help us to know how we can give our lives self-sacrificially for you, the one who gives us every single breath that we breathe and the one who has secured our future both now and for the future. We worship you now. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.